Thank you for coming. This is the final session that we're going to look at, and it's intellectual freedom, copyright, and censorship. These are things that we have touched on in bits and pieces already, so it shouldn't be difficult for you to follow what we are going to do. Now, freedom of expression and freedom of information are considered to be part of the natural rights of human beings, and therefore they are captured in the United Nations Charter on Human Rights. It is also captured in our 1992 Constitution that governs Ghana now. So the objective that we are hoping to achieve is that we should be able to explain the terms copyright and censorship. We should be able to understand the implication of fair use in copyright, identify the various types of censorship, understand various levels of intellectual property. And the topics that we'll cover will be intellectual freedom, censorship, copyright. Intellectual freedom. We define intellectual freedom as the freedom and the right to think without government interference. So Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 19, says that everyone has a right to freedom of expression and opinion. Everyone has a right to seek, receive, and impart information, ideas. Promotion of intellectual freedom. It's promoted by several professions and movements. Education, librarianship, free software movements, the library profession. Intellectual freedom is a core responsibility of the library profession, where librarians are enjoined not to have any politics, not to have any philosophies, they don't have any religion. They are fair to everybody. Well, this wiki, intellectual freedom deals with the right to say, do, and think without restriction. That is a library information science wiki, which is a subset of Wikipedia. They identified intellectual freedom, or they know that intellectual freedom deals with the right to say, do, and think without restrictions. Of course, there are responsibilities there too. And libraries provide access to ideas, no matter how unpopular they are. The American Library Association, for example, declares that it is the right of every individual to both seek and receive information from all points of view without restriction. Now, IFLA, which is an international federation of library associations and institutions, urges libraries and library staff to adhere to the principles of intellectual freedom. And then they should recognize the privacy of library users, and urges member associations to actively promote the acceptance and realization of the principles of intellectual freedom. National Library Associations are to expand the principles. So IFLA has been also in the forefront of the advocacy for freedom of information, which for us in this part of the world is a big issue. Like I've said earlier on, the Freedom of Information Bill has been in Parliament for close to 25 years now. Then there is the issue of censorship. Again, this is something that we have touched on in passing in our previous discussions. Censorship is a deletion or excision of parts of published materials. So over the years, there have been efforts to ban, prohibit, suppress, proscribe, remove, label, or restrict materials that are made available to information seekers and information users. Sometimes also we have prohibition of distribution, circulation, or display of work by governing authority. Again, another definition by main wiki is a suppression of speech or other communication which may be considered objectionable, harmful, sensitive, or inconvenient to the general public. So these are definitions of what we call censorship. It can occur before or after the release of a work to the public. Sometimes government may decide to stop a particular information from coming out, or after the information has come out, they will decide to stop it. So we have preventing censorship, which is the application of restraints before dissemination of the material. Then we have punitive censorship, which is applied after the publication of the material. Of course, there are historical antecedents of censorship. And so evidence exists in history all over the various stages of civilizations. So we have Cato the Elder, one of the renowned censors of the Roman Empire. Ashurbanipal, who lived and reigned between 668 to 627 BC, was an Assyrian king. Now he removed clay tablets which he considered to be objectionable from the king's library. There was also censorship in the Roman public libraries, where Emperor Julian, who also reigned between 361 to 363 CE, was the founder of Roman libraries in Constantinople, also attempted to destroy all Christian texts. Then Socrates promoted freedom of thinking, but he refused to allow the teaching and works to be his teaching and works to be censored. We all know what happened to him. Those of you who are into classical history and civilization, I'm sure you know about. Then there was also the issue of Plato, who was a disciple of Socrates, who also defended censorship. There are different reasons for the various types of information that are censored. We have moral censorship, where obscene or profane materials, for example, pornography, will not be allowed in a library. There is also military censorship, where military intelligence and military tactics will not be put in the public domain. We have political censorship, where governments hold back information from their citizens. For example, as I said earlier on, the Gitmo prisoners who were brought into the country surreptitiously before it was announced that we have accepted to host such prisoners from Guantanamo Bay. There are also crime and violence censorship, where we have restriction on books, films, and magazines that show too much violence. Then, of course, we have religious censorship, which is suppression of materials considered to be objectionable by a certain faith. Then we have corporate censorship, disruption of publication by editors in corporate media of information that portray their business negatively. For example, if you are fighting against the Daily Graphic or Daily Guardian, you want to publish your fight in their own newspapers, they will not publish it. Then censorship and the library. Librarians are not supposed to have any forms of bias, whether political, religious, moral, social, gender. Librarians are therefore to provide all manner of materials in whatever form to everybody. And most libraries receive the bulk of their funding from government. And so if government decides that you should not put a certain kind of material there, or there's nothing you can do about it. Government policy on differentiation of information can affect libraries. Even sometimes the society itself, or reaction of the society to certain aspects of information may also affect libraries. For example, when the Satanic Verses was published in 1975, there was a whole uproar worldwide against it by Muslims or practitioners of the Islamic faith. In Ghana, for example, in Lagos here, there was a seminar that was organized to discuss the book. And before the seminar could start, there were busloads of Muslim youth from Nima who came and disrupted the whole program. So the program couldn't come on. Then there's also the internet, which exposes users to all types of information. And then, so there have been attempts to control information on the internet, even though it is quite difficult. But there are software and programs to block undesirable sites. Here on Legon campus, for example, UGCS has introduced software that blocks access to certain areas of the internet. Then there's the issue of copyright, which again I have talked about in passing in our previous discussions. Basically, copyright protects the creators of intellectual works. And so we have looked at the purpose of copyright, which limits the copying, the change, the performance, or the share of a person's intellectual property. There is also the aspect of fair use in copyright. In other words, even though the copyright law protects and prevents people from taking undue advantage of the works of a creator of an intellectual property, there is fair use, which allows the copying, the use of a certain amount of a person's work without recourse to permission from the person. And fair use requires that kind of copying should be for the purpose of teaching, study, research, critique, etc. So if you are not going to use it for these kinds of purposes, then obviously you will need to ask permission of the user before you can use it. Now the Berne Convention is a convention that spells out the terms of copyright, and a lot of countries, including Ghana, are signatories to the convention. In Ghana, we also have our own copyright law. there are implications of copyright for libraries. There are restrictions on copying. And so if you go to BAM library, you will not be allowed to copy a whole book. Only about a tenth of the book can be allowed to be copied. Not so with those commercial photocopiers outside there who copy everything for you, which is wrong and criminal in any case. In Ghana, Copyright Act 690 of 2005 is there. You can look it up and then see how we protect the properties of people who create music, people who write books, people who produce films. So in the main, this is what we are all about. We've come to the end of the course, and I hope you have benefited. As I pointed out, this is a course that more or less introduces you to the various aspects of the other courses that you'll be taking, level 200, level 300, and level 400. I hope you have enjoyed the course. Good luck in your exams. These are some references that you may be minded to look up for more information in the areas that we have covered. Thank you very much.